Thank you, Ken Corlett. First of all, can I thank Deputy Brady for bringing forward this motion, and I was happy to add my name to it. Now, when it comes to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, there are no easy answers. If there were, we would have found them by now. A two-state solution is the only solution, but that only works where there's trust. And there is no trust. We have seen one UN Security Council resolution after another flagrantly ignored by Israel, dismissed. We see Palestinians herded into the open prison of the Gaza Strip, often with no proper access to clean water, sanitation, energy, medical supplies. Many Palestinians have no future. And when you have no future, then you have no hope for the future. And all you can do is revolt. This is not an equal conflict, and it cannot be approached from that perspective. The reality of oppression, the hardline oppression of Palestinians, the denial of their life chances, the denial of hope, has created a cauldron of anger, bitterness, and distrust. Annexation of stolen land, illegal settlements, forced evictions stoke the fires of conflict. This is a David and Goliath situation, and we know it. The Palestinians are not blameless. We must recognise that. But we must place the responsibility where it belongs, squarely on the shoulders of Israel. There have been many attempts to negotiate peace between Israel and the Palestinians over the years, with many interventions by those who created the problems in the first place, when the British, French, and Americans carved up the Middle East in their own interest. Today, self-interest is still the dominating influence on their policies, which have significantly involved oil, arms supplies, and election outcomes, notably in the US. Self-interest, unfortunately, has almost always been a contributing factor to this conflict. Those who are responsible for the creation of the nations of Israel and Palestine are core veto holders of permanent seats in the UN Security Council. Now, Minister, I've heard what you had to say and what Ambassador Bernaysen had to say, both inside and outside the UN, and I fully support you. But sometimes words are not enough. Your pledge on Ireland's accession to the Security Council seat was powerful when you said, "This means saying no at times and standing up for ourselves and our principles, even when it is a friend coming calling." Now, the power of those words will be immense if we back them up. If we say no, we must mean no. And I understand, Minister, it's easy for me to ask you to act, but I do so in good faith and not in any attempt to back you into a corner, because I believe your heart and your head are in the right place. Deputy Haaland spoke of the actions of the Norwegian wealth funds. The world's largest sovereign wealth fund has excluded two Israeli companies because of their work in construction in the Gaza Strip. This is a 1.3 trillion fund, and the Independent Council of Ethics that advises them said, "Israeli settlements in the West Bank have been built in violation of international law. Their existence and constant expansion causes significant harm and disadvantage to the area's Palestinian population." Now, Minister, their action is a small step, but it matters. And we need to take a step also. We could pass the Occupied Territories Bill. That would be a statement and a step. But whatever we do, we need to move beyond mere condemnation. We cannot salve our conscience by words or by sending aid. Both are necessary but not sufficient. We know it won't work. It has never worked. And you know what I think, Minister? I think we won't be alone if we take that step. And I'm asking you and your colleagues to do this. And even if we are alone, it'll be the right thing, and it will give heft to the words you used on our accession to the Security Council seat. We need to say no, and we need to mean it.